We'll move on to Erica here. This is something that we learned last year. Really getting a patient perspective was very valuable to most of you guys, and I think it did add some humanity to what we've talked about, because so far it's all digital health, and it's all AI, you know, making us more efficient, more robotic. Ultimately, the goal of these tools is that it allows providers to have more time with their patients and allow us to be face-to-face with you again, because we're not typing our notes looking in the computer. And I think Erica's story will be compelling for that. She's a two-time breast cancer survivor with two different journeys. The first one was what I experienced when I had my kidney cancer, which is just fear and trauma. And then she had a second one and was much less about process and much more about mental and emotional health and the physical toll that the cancer diagnosis could take on the caregivers and the cancer patients themselves. And she decided to do something about it. So she has now invested a lot of time and talent and resources into helping others through their cancer story. She's created a supportive oncology services project through her leadership Lexington class, served as a member of the Markey Cancer Center's patient advisory group, and through the ACS Cancer Action Network, lobbied state and national legislatures to increase funding for cancer services and prevention programs. She received her bachelor's in psychology from the University of Chicago, holds a master's degree in social work from the University of Kentucky, founder and former owner and CEO and hospital administrator for Bluegrass, Veterinary Supplies and Animal Emergency, graduate of Commerce, Lexington Leadership, Lexington Program, and Leadership Kentucky. 2014 Leadership Lexington Distinguished Leader and co-recipient of the 2017 Leadership Kentucky Lisa Morell Award. Please welcome Erica.
Have you ever had a nagging question in your life? One that itches at your soul? Or for this room, a hypothesis that you feel compelled to test? A what if? Well, I have. And the origin of my question dates back 17 years. In October of 2006, I was 9 months pregnant, and I should have been excitedly anticipating the birth of my fourth daughter. Instead, I was getting a breast ultrasound, except I felt this strange area in my left breast. The findings stated that there was a large band of fibrous parenchyma through the region of concern, but no discrete masses were identified. The impression, benign. Great. Life went on, and 14 days later, I gave birth to my daughter, Raina. The next 5 months looked pretty typical for a family of six, although balancing the emotional and physical demands of my three energetic school-aged children and an infant and surviving sleep deprivation was a big adjustment. Somehow, I made it work. On one school day, I took advantage of the emptiness of my house and settled down to relish the much-appreciated, quiet, one-on-one time to nurse Raina. We snuggled up on the couch with a pillow supporting her little body. I gently stroked her cheek and lovingly stared at her face. It was such an innocent moment. But as she nursed, I felt a twinge of pain. I touched it, and it felt hard, but it was tender. It was a lump in my breast. I immediately called my OB. My doctor, knowing I was breastfeeding and had no family or personal history, thought it was likely a clogged milk duct. But out of an abundance of caution, she ordered a mammogram. I was told that the mammogram showed no evidence of a tumor, and she advised conservative treatment using warm compresses, massage, and regular feedings. Whew, this was great news. Not only did I not have cancer, but at 33, all my hopes, dreams, and aspirations I envisioned lay right in front of me. You see, before getting married, my husband and I agreed to support one another through our respective careers. He, a board-certified internal medicine veterinary specialist, would first complete his training, and then once established, I would complete mine and go to medical school. My starting line was just over the horizon. But, as you know, day turns into night. And in July of 2008, after a particularly challenging morning, like all good mothers do, I decided to take my frustration out by scrubbing a toilet. I was mid-scrub when suddenly I felt a quiet, subtle itch in my left breast. I stopped, wiped my brow, put down the brush, pulled off the gloves, and scratched. In that moment, all the air in my lungs escaped. I froze, staring at my terrified reflection. A few seconds that felt like a lifetime passed. I collected myself and then gently ran my fingers over the area again. To my horror, this time, I felt a pea-sized, non-movable, hard lump. I knew instantly life would not just simply go on. A punch biopsy confirmed I had ERPR positive, HER2 negative invasive ductal carcinoma. The next 3 years were a blur. They were consumed with scans, multiple surgeries, copious doctor's appointments, genetic testing and counseling, chemotherapy, near-death anaphylaxis, and implant infection, hospitalizations, more surgery, the onset of anxiety and post-traumatic stress from all of it while trying to adjust to the side effects of tamoxifen. Oof, it was a lot. But what was particularly gut-wrenching was learning that I was BRCA1 positive. Yep, that's right. Not only did I have breast cancer this time, but me, the mother of four girls with supposedly no family or personal history of breast cancer, a BRCA1 carrier. I'm not sure I can adequately describe the impact of that information, but suffice it to say that it landed like a heavyweight punch to the gut. It meant my daughters now each had a 50% chance of being BRCA1 positive as well. It felt like a sick joke. Sick joke or not, though, all good jokes need a great punchline, and mine was this. For generational reasons, which I will never understand, my mother never told me that we actually do have a family history of breast cancer. This broken thread weaves through my father's side of the family. It was clearly an important detail I wish she had shared, but she didn't. Ultimately, it was my touch and genetic testing which revealed this secret. So in celebration of the advanced technology of the day and to empower her with personal agency, I shared my BRCA status with her. This proved to be life-preserving information, because even though she eventually developed breast cancer, diligent surveillance caught it very early. She received treatment and is still alive today. I do wonder, though, what would have happened after my first ultrasound had I known I had a family history. But thanks to advanced technology and genetic testing, this is a question my daughters will never have to ask. I wish I could tell you my story ends here, but it doesn't. It will continue with my daughters. And even though I only had stage 1 invasive ductal carcinoma and followed all of the medical advice, I never felt at ease. I always felt the proverbial monkey on my back, or in my case, in my armpit. 3 short years after my initial diagnosis, I felt another itch. This time in my left palm. This itch was relentless. It drove me nuts. I would scratch and scratch and scratch, but that itch just wouldn't go away. An alarm bell started blaring in my head. Then, while staying in a hotel for one of my daughter's many gymnastics meets, I woke up in the middle of the night with nerve pain shooting down my arm. Obviously, I knew this was not good. I paid close attention to the pain, analyzing its trajectory. I did a quick Google search to locate the nerve's origin and figured out it was somewhere in my armpit. The hunt was on. I poked and I prodded, but I couldn't feel anything while I was lying down. When I got out of bed in the morning, I was able to lean over and contort myself in a strange position, and boom, I found it. It was back. By now, I'm sure you're all wondering why I was asked to share my patient story, because clearly the time of AI is not my lived experience. It had no value to me while I traveled my cancer journey. However, for me, its value comes at the now, and that value is twofold. Today, I'm living in the hope of what AI can offer the future, especially for my daughters. But the future depends on the information of the past and learning the value it holds. Speaking at this conference gave me a chance to finally answer my big what-if question, because I had the possibility to run my past digital x-ray through AI software. In doing so, I spent over 4 weeks searching for my 2007 digital mammogram. I contacted providers and hospitals using apps, email, the phone, and ultimately had to go old school and went in person. I had discussions about picture archiving and communication systems, health information systems, electronic medical records, backups, this system, that system, and guess what? Do you know what I found? Nothing. My imaging was gone, deleted. Poof. Finding this out was a deep and personal loss, because with it, I lost the ability to answer my what-if question. What if my cancer was present 15 months prior to my diagnosis, or 2 years before on that ultrasound? What if technology could have detected my cancer earlier? How would my outcome be different? What wouldn't I have lost? Would I actually be sitting where you are instead of standing up here with an MD after my name? Would I not have to worry about being able to hear a fire alarm at night or miss out on the secret whispers my daughter shared because chemotherapy saved my life, but it stole my hearing? Would I be able to wear the perfectly fitting shirt because I didn't have to size up due to lymphedema in my left arm? These are questions I will never be able to answer. But believe it or not, these are not the losses that cut the deepest. It's the lost opportunity to have my experience help others in advanced science. You see, we know what happened to me, and we should be able to go back and review how my case progressed from an ultrasound taken nearly 2 years before my diagnosis to a mammogram 4 to 6 months prior to the time I found that undeniable pea-sized cancerous lump. But we can't. Why? How can this be? We had the beginning of EMRs. We had advanced technologies in 2006. We had digital x-rays, PACS, RIS. But we also had laws and guidelines recommending medical retention periods. And these periods vary state to state and provider to provider. There is no consistency. For me, the magic medical retention period was 10 years. But my cancer saga started 17 years ago, and I'm still here. You see, mine is not just a question about the cost to me. My question is, what is the existential cost to the rest of us? Could my past medical history and old records and imaging benefit not only the well-being of my children, but their children and your children and other BRCA-positive women and breast cancer research in general? That is the lost opportunity. It is a loss for science to learn, and it is compounded because now neither people nor machines can learn from my images. And this nagging itch can't be scratched. This is so important to me because I don't want another young pregnant woman or nursing mother with no personal or family history who presents with similar findings to lose 7 productive years of her life. I want us to stop and say, hey, wait a minute. We know what this benign band of fibrous parenchyma will likely look like in 2 years. What are we gonna do about it? Should we run her images through the learned systems of AI? Should she get genetic testing, even though it's benign and she has no family history? Should she follow enhanced surveillance protocols? Do we actually need to review and adapt certain guidelines to catch up to advances in technology? Or even though she is BRCA negative, like my oldest daughter, Julia, knows now, do we need to surveil her differently? Technology is advancing at the speed of light, but if we don't slow down and reflect on the decisions of the past and value the old new technologies and more importantly, preserve the cases of the past, we will lose so much information. You see, I wanted AI to learn from my case so you could learn for your cases. But as the system currently stands, we will continue to unintentionally erase the answers to today's questions, but the potential life-saving answers for tomorrow. While my story does end here, it doesn't end with me. It continues with my daughters. This is Julia. She's 23. And recently graduated from the University of Chicago. She has 3 scientific publications under her belt and is currently applying to grad school. This is my daughter, Alexis. She plans to become an English professor and is hoping to compete at the NCAA championships for the 3rd year in a row. This is her twin, Camille. She's a junior at Cornell and spent last summer training to become a nationally certified EMT. She will get that MD after her name. And this is Arena. She's a happy, healthy, hockey-playing, creative-writing junior in high school, and one day she hopes to play in the PWHL. You see, my daughters have their whole lives ahead of them. How can we use technology to ensure they get to live their lives to their full potential? I implore you, whatever your nagging question, explore it. Never stop asking questions. And even if you think you have the answer, ask another. I need to thank a couple people, so please bear with me. I'd like to thank the Markey Cancer Center for its life-saving treatment, Director Dr. Mark Evers, and the organizers for today's symposium, specifically Dr. Jill Kalesser, who requested a patient advocate to speak. I'd also like to thank Dr. Pamela Hull for her championing of patient advocacy at the Markey Cancer Center, and particularly patient advocacy manager, Mr. Terry Keyes. I'd also like to express the deepest gratitude to Dr. Ed Ramond for not only giving me the best medical care, but for being a pioneer in breast cancer research and treatment. And I'd like to thank all of you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions you have about my experience. Thank you.
So she hit the personalization, she hit the participation part of Dr. Hood's thing. I don't worry about participation of patients if they're adequately informed. And I feel your story. My mom died of breast cancer, I think, at 42. I'm a BARD1 carrier. My daughter's 23, applying to med school. And these are the thoughts that patients have. So for those of you in the room who aren't patient touching, this is why we talk about the technologies. This is why we're talking about AI, talking about personalizing medicine so that each individual human life, those four, hers, can be affected by the science that you guys are conducting, the papers that you're publishing, the bench work that you're doing, and translational research that's bringing these new tools to pass, the stuff that you're discovering so that you can diagnose earlier, more accurately, faster, with fewer scared women with false positives. So thank you for your story. I would welcome questions. I know everybody's sort of in shock. That happens when we have patients talk. Dr. Arnold? Sure.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Makes me tear up too. Where do you think the patient should exist in their own data? Do you want a copy of everything? Do you want to have it all at your house?
I'm going to be 100% honest with you. This is something that I've thought about deeply. And I actually wish we could move to the point where, in essence, we have our own medical record fingerprint in the sense that that is available to us from every single provider that we see, and it is nice and neatly categorized by body system or however it needs to be, because this is important, and we do still struggle today with integration of systems and having everything play nicely together. If I am the owner of my medical history, and it is at my disposal, like it should be today, that gives me the power to share that with the necessary persons and not spend hours trying to find it. Yeah. Yeah.
I think those are the looks that we wanted to see, which is they're reflecting. And that's what we're supposed to do. As we put these conferences together, this is the whole point. You know, all of us are touched by this, 1 in 2 men, 1 in 3 women. As we gain experience with these technologies, we can save you.